Good morning. Welcome to Dutch. We're glad that you're here to worship Jesus with us this morning. Let's stand up and I'll open us in prayer and we'll sing. Heavenly Father, we're thankful that we get to gather in your presence this morning. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Sing along with us. Morning. We're going to sing a new song. It's new to all of us. And it's a song called Do What You Want To. And it's a prayer to God saying, God, we've come here this morning. We surrender ourselves to you. We submit to whatever you want to do in our lives, in the lives of our church this morning. Whatever you want to do, God, just do it. And that's what we're going to be singing this morning. So I hope you can join along with us. Clap along if you can't figure out the words yet, but we'll be doing this in the next couple of weeks so you can learn it. Let's put our hands together.
Your glory fill this place. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders.
Presence of my Savior.
Jesus, this morning, we just want to say that we trust you with our lives, with all that we have, God. We surrender it to you, and we ask, Lord, that you would do within us whatever you want to this season of Lent, that you would shape us and transform us from the inside out. Take this offering of ourselves to you, Lord, and may it be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Take a second and greet some folks who are standing around you.
Hey, everybody. Gosh, you're looking good. Some of you are looking extra good because you're growing mustaches and beards for the youth. Woohoo! Oh, that's it. All right. Yeah. I want to invite the kids to come up now if you'd like. And I have a little something to share with you. Hey, it's good that you're here. Come on up. Hey, it's nice to see you. Come on up. What I want to tell you today is that because of what Jesus did when he died on the cross, he made it possible for those who love him to go to heaven. And today in the Bible, we will read about these two criminals that were crucified at the same time Jesus was. And one of them said, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Today you're going to be with me in paradise." That's a really cool thing, isn't it? So I invite you to be able to remember that Jesus makes it possible for those who die to be with him in paradise. That's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Paradise is really cool. It's better than the best day you can imagine. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for making it possible for us and for all those we love to be with you in paradise. We thank you for making that possible. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you like a piece of candy? There you go. Have a piece. There you go. Just for you. Would you like a piece of candy? You're welcome. You're welcome. Now's a pretty special time because Julia Ray is one of the ones that went with the Zoe group, and she's going to share a little bit about her experience on her second trip to Rwanda. Julia?
Good morning. I'm going to talk to you about a young man named Joseph. Joseph is somewhere around 14 years old. He looks like he's about 7. The last year my niece went, the year before that my sister went, and the year before that I went. Joseph was in the big group kind of getting settled in when I went before. And then the year my sister went, she noticed Joseph. She noticed the feet covered with flies, the hands with the same issue, that Joseph was frail and small and not quite as strong as the others. He touched her heart. She could see that he had special needs, that he was going to be a tough one to reach out to, and for him to be able to understand and grasp the program, and for us to make a difference in his life. Last year when my niece Kathy went, he didn't show up at the group meeting when we were here. They had to talk Epiphany and Debbie and Kathy to getting in a truck and going and finding him. We think he was kind of embarrassed to go to the group meeting because he was not doing well. Joseph was struggling. You can see how tiny he is compared to Nate. And to think that he was a teenager. You can see here that the others reach out to him. I took about four pictures in a row of the group with Joseph there in the center front, and every time someone had their hand on his shoulder or on his side somewhere. They first assigned a grandmother to be someone to help him, to be there in the home with him. And people in the village knew that he was a Zoe kid. They would come in and steal everything that he had. So he was unable to prosper. So they assigned different ones of the orphans to come and check up on him, to try to help him to be able to keep what he had earned. And that really wasn't working. When I was here this year, I noticed how small he was. I took pictures, and my sister and I compared the pictures from the last 3 years, and you could tell that he hadn't grown any taller. That's an old picture of his hands. That's from either last year or the year before. And they look, you know, just the same now. And it just, he breaks our heart. We talked to Epiphany about it. She's the head person for Rwanda. And instead of being out in the countryside where he's been, that's him there full of, sunshine. And they're going to build him a small house there in the village near other orphans so that it will be easy for others to check up on him, to help him with his small business grant. So even though it's at the end of their cycle, they're not giving up on Joseph. He's going to continue to get support from Project Zoe so that he can be successful in life and to be able to make something of himself. And it just, you know, we are praying for Joseph every day in my family because we know that he continues to have needs. And it just breaks our hearts to have seen the flies on his feet and how much he has failed to grow, you know, failed to, you know, that head was not held up high. You know, anything showing that he, you know, gathered any self-esteem or done better for himself. So if you would pray for Joseph as well, I would appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. If you would like to support one of the orphans or more, it takes about $350 to put one through the three-year program, and you could pull out one of the little yellow Zoe slips in the pew there. It doesn't matter when you give the $350, just as long as it's given before the end of the year, it will support the orphans that we saw this year that need adopting. There are about 200 that need adopting, and already, in just about a month, Duck Church has adopted 77 of them. Isn't that really cool? Yeah. You're really amazing. Now, if the ushers will come forward, we'll receive the morning tithes and offerings. Thank you. No rush. We always stay late anyway. That was really good. I'm excited about the message I've got for you today. It's one of the best messages ever. And not because of the bringer, but because of what Jesus did and what Jesus has to say. You know, we're in this new sermon series about the seven last words of Jesus from the cross. There's not a whole lot of talking going on, and there's a reason for that. First of all, most of us don't usually get real chatty when we're in a lot of pain. Right, but the other thing is the way the cross system works is it's meant to asphyxiate you. That's pretty much what you die of, is asphyxiation, because what happens is you're suspended in such a way that all the weight of your body kind of presses in upon your lungs. And so in order to get a breath of air, you have to kind of support yourself. And of course, when you do, it means you have to be kind of tearing against those nails that are fastening you to the cross. So not a whole lot of deep breathing going on and not a whole lot of conversation. So the words of Jesus from the cross are pretty succinct. So that's the setting for where we are from now until the end of Lent, which is six Sundays. I'm here in Luke chapter 23. You remember Jesus is not crucified by himself. Jesus is crucified with two other fellows. They're both thieves. It says here, one of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding Jesus and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we're getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Paradise. Have we got any students at First Flight? Yeah, we got some First Flight students. First Flight is one of the best high schools in the great state of North Carolina. Would you call it paradise? Huh? Yeah, it isn't, is it? No. Now, there are some people here who are in their 80s that might not mind being like 16 again, but if they have any kind of a memory left, they know that 16, exciting or depressing as it may have been, it is not paradise. What about maybe, you know, that in your 20s age? Yeah, it's challenging, it's difficult, and most of you have your health in your 20s, but it's not paradise. I always wanted to be 37 and wear wingtips. Isn't that strange? But, you know, I'm strange. I freely admit that, a stranger, yeah, strange person. But always, you know, when I was a teenager and all growing up, I'm like, I'm just looking forward to being 37 and wearing wingtips. I know. Joe Cool, that's me, yeah. 37 was really good. It was really good. But I tell you something, baby, it won't paradise. No. And just in case I ever get confused about that, I have journals from that year. Just read through them. Doesn't sound like paradise to me. Anybody here Boy Scout? Were you a Boy Scout? Yeah? Nice. You were a Boy Scout? Then you can probably say with me, a Scout is trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. Thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. Thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. Yeah, a lot of Roman Catholics. A lot of Roman Catholics manage that whole deal. Not too many Methodists get that. Yeah. Roman Catholics, they're better with that trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. Yeah, Methodists, I don't know, especially that reverent part. I don't think we've quite got that yet. Now, it reminds me of when I was about 12 years old, I was a tenderfoot, and I was on a Boy Scout camping trip, and for some reason or other, I was around the campfire with the Scoutmaster. I don't know why it was just me and T. Ben Douglas, but that's what it was. Ben Douglas was kind of a foreboding, forbidding, frightening sort of fellow, even though he was a member of my dad's Lake Waccamaw United Methodist Church. But we're sitting around the campfire, and I don't know how, but somehow the subject of dying came up. And I said, yeah, I'm looking forward to that. You know, and I could tell he thought that was a little surprising, but frankly, I was surprised that he was a grown-up and didn't look like he was really looking forward to it. And he's like, well, you know, I know that, you know, as Christians, we're looking forward to going to heaven eventually. But don't you have some things you want to accomplish before you die? I'm like, no, not especially. He's like, well, and he's just starting to get a little flustered, and he's like, well, don't you want to grow up and have children, get married and have children before you die? No, not particularly. Well, don't you want to at least graduate from college before you die? No, not especially. Don't you want to at least graduate from high school before you die? Well, no, not particularly. He's getting a little frustrated. I realize that he's concerned. I mean, I was 12, but I wasn't stupid. And so I'm realizing that he's uncomfortable with this conversation. And I'm giving him answers that, for whatever reason, make him uncomfortable. And so he says, isn't there anything that you want to do or accomplish before you die? And I said, well, I would like to make first class. He said, well, then you're not ready to die yet. I'm like, okay. Yeah. He ended the conversation, got up and moved on. He was kind of uncomfortable. He probably thought he had a suicidal teenager on his hand. And, you know, I mean, that is a scary thing. But, you know, it's like, I wasn't suicidal. I'm just not stupid. You know, when God tells me that I can trade in this life for paradise, it's like, that is what my brother calls a white meat decision. You know, it doesn't take long to make that choice. So, yeah. In fact, the other day, somebody was telling me, an older person in the congregation was telling me that they are going to be okay. They're not going to die yet. They're looking forward to going to heaven, but not today. And I just offhandedly said, suit me fine to go today. It was so sweet. She said, and how are you doing, Pastor John? You know, it's like, no, I'm doing fine. I'm happy as a clam. You know, I get to be a Methodist preacher. That's a wonderful thing. And not only do I get to be a Methodist preacher, I get to be the Methodist preacher for one of the greatest congregations on the face of the earth. You really believe that a great way to show your love for God is to love your neighbor. I love that. That is wonderful. But baby, this ain't paradise. Is it? It is not. It's good. But it's not paradise. You know, I quote this book to you from time to time because I like it a lot. It's Scott Peck. He's a psychiatrist. It's this book called The Road Less Traveled. And it begins saying, life is difficult. It's not just difficult for you. Life is difficult for everybody. And once we get used to this fact, it's not quite as difficult. He says, some people go through life thinking that life is supposed to be easy and that there's something wrong with their lives because it's not as easy as they think life is supposed to be. But he says, life isn't easy. It's not easy for anybody. I call it effortful. I find life effortful. And sometimes it's not just effortful, sometimes it's really difficult. And sometimes it's not just difficult. Sometimes it's excruciating. That's life. Sometimes it's wonderful. Sometimes it's effortful. Sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes it's excruciating. That's life. And then there's paradise. You know what paradise is. Paradise is a place of utter perfection and pleasure. That's paradise. It's an odd thing to me about Christians and this going to heaven business. When somebody dies and they've been sick for a long time and their body is emaciated and life has become just so painful and so difficult that just to die is a relief. You follow me? That just, it's better not to be than to be the way you are at that point. And when that person dies, someone will usually say, she's in a better place. He's in a better place. And of course, you know, I hear that and I agree, but what I've noticed is rarely do you hear anybody say that about anybody under 40 who was in good health and died suddenly. But I got some good news for you today. I don't care if you die young. I don't care if you die in the picture of health with everything ahead of you. Paradise is better than here every single day of the week. Paradise beats life here every single time. So when you start thinking about transitioning from this life into the next, it's nothing but good. It's nothing but gain. Hallelujah. So I just repeat it. When the Lord is ready for me, I'm ready to go. When the Lord is ready for me, I'm not going to go try to run and hide and say, oh, can't I just have another week or two here? You know? No, sirree, baby. I'm going to be like, really? Is it time? Let's go. Yes. It reminds me of Christmas morning when I was a child. There were four of us, and we always woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Always. It didn't vary more than 10 minutes. It might be 5 minutes till 3. It might be 5 minutes past 3. But it was right at 3 o'clock. We would wake up. Now, not all of us at one time. Different ones of us would wake up, you know, first, different Christmases. I'd be in the bed. And, you know, you remember what it's like? You go to bed on Christmas Eve when you're a child, and you're just hoping to go to sleep. And it's really, really hard. And you think this is probably not ever going to happen. You might lie there for an hour and a half, like, gotta go to sleep, gotta sleep. Santa Claus can't come if I don't go to sleep. I gotta go to sleep, right? Finally, you drift off to sleep. And the next thing I would know is Catherine or Jack or George Hart would be in my room shaking me. John, wake up. Santa Claus came. You know? Eyes pop open, jump out of the bed. We go to the living room, flip on the light, and there the living room would be packed with everything that Santa Claus brought. And I tell you what, in the South, Santa Claus doesn't rap. Now, you Yankees, he raps. In the South, Santa Claus doesn't rap. And if you're Southern and you're rapping, you got that somewhere else. That's fine. I'm not poking fun. Rap gifts are a lot of fun, but the way it would work at our house is you flip on the light and it's all there at one time. I tell you what, that was good. We go in there and we wake up mom and daddy, you know, and they say, just go ahead and enjoy it. I thought that was the strangest thing. Oh my goodness. But anyway, see, to me, and I think to most of us who believe, the idea of going to heaven is like waking up and it's suddenly Christmas morning. That's the good news of the gospel. Now, let's transition for just a minute. That's not unmitigated joy for those who are left behind. For those of us who are left behind, there's an enormous amount of sadness and grief that we may never fully get over. And that's difficult. And for that, we need the comfort and the care of the family of God. And we need the comfort and the miraculous peace of the Holy Spirit of God. But the good news for you and for me today is that Jesus said to the thief on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise." The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That is a wonderful thing every single day. It doesn't matter how bright your future looks in this world, to be in heaven is even better. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. We come now to the time for the Holy Communion. We're going to have Holy Communion today by intinction. And so as you come up from the center aisle, you'll just put one hand on top of the other like sinners begging for the grace of God, because that's what we all are. Yeah. The bread will be placed in your hands with the words, "The body of Christ broken for you." And then you'll put the bread just slightly in the cup. If you put it all the way down in the cup, it's going to fall apart in there, okay? Just, you know, communion etiquette. So you put the bread just slightly in the cup. You'll hear the words, "The blood of Christ shed for you," and you say amen or thanks be to God, and you eat it. And you know that taste of Welch's grape juice, that's what forgiveness tastes like to me, you know? I've associated all my life, you know, the taste of Welch's with the knowledge of forgiveness. That's a sweet taste. And then just return to your seat by the side aisle. The liturgy's on the screen. Let's pray together. We have the great Thanksgiving, so I invite you to stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, it is right that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you. On the night that the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and blessed it, broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and after he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." This is the body of Christ broken for the sins of the world. This is the blood of Christ poured out for the sins of the world. You may be seated. Let those who will assist with the communion come forward. Bye. body of Christ broken for you. The 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 blood of Christ shed 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 for you. Come to the feast, for all is now ready.
Let's stand together and pray. Lord Jesus, we're grateful for your death on the cross, that by that death we might experience your forgiveness, and that one day when our race here on earth is done, we will be with you in paradise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Never failing, let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of the Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender it. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world sing. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Oh, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Oh, forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Receive this benediction. And now unto Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the throne of grace with exceeding joy, unto the only wise God be honor, glory, dominion, and power, and may the love of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author. I'll sound